Hello everyone, welcome to Inside Spurs here at Hotspur Way with all of the build-up to every Spurs game. Just 8 games to go, Spurs 5th in the table and a huge game coming up this weekend against Nottingham Forest. Here's what's coming up on the show today. 8 games to go for this group and anything still very much possible. We'll catch up with Tyrese Hall with our under-21s still top of the table. And Mickey van der Ven is with us on the sofa to look ahead to Forest. And with me today in the studio, Stephen Kelly. Stephen, what did you make of the draw against West Ham?
Yeah, it was there for us, wasn't it? I think that's what you could see, the frustration of the players at the end of the game. They were disappointed not to win. And every time I'm on here and we haven't won a game, that's there, which is evident of the progress I think the club's making, where they feel they should be. West Ham have been a very good side this season, competing on a couple of different fronts, some wonderful standout players, and we really nullified them. And the win was there for us. So disappointing not to come away with all 3 points, but it's still a point on the board, and we're still in that hunt for the fourth spot.
Yeah, perhaps frustration is the overriding emotion. We can see the full-time scenes. I mean, straight away, my eyes just look out for Sonny within this, because you can see the disappointment in his face.
And the thing is, it's wonderful that the players are feeling that frustrated in the game, whereas time's gone by, that would have been like, it's a good point, where no, they're disappointed that they haven't gone and won that because they felt the chances were there, they felt that they created enough opportunities, and they're disappointed. So I just think all that the players would be disappointed, but something that they're going to try and build on and go into the next game and not let those chances go away like they did in this one.
Having said that, there is an opportunity this weekend to make it 2 wins out of the last 3, 7 points from 9, and make it a really, really strong week for Spurs.
Yeah, important. The really important game this weekend against a team who are, you know, rejuvenated a little bit, I think, the points differential, but I think Tottenham are going to go into this full of it, I think, ready for this game and build on what they did in the West Ham one.
Yeah, talk me through sort of what it's like when you have these games in short periods of time. I mean, now we've seen the fixture changes come through. We'll come onto that in a bit. But it's suddenly thick and fast, isn't it? Game, game, game at the back end of the season.
It is. And I think for top teams, this is it all throughout the year, because you go from game, game, game in the league, if you're Europa League, if you're in the Champions League, and then you go to international breaks and you have 2 close games again. So it's just non-stop till the summer, and even then you've got games. So these players are well conditioned for that, and it's getting that momentum. If you can hit a run of games where you're just going win to win, then 3 or 4 games, 3 or 4 wins on the back, and all of a sudden you're looking at a different outset. So I think it's important that we just get that momentum going again and get that confidence in the group, and I think we can this weekend.
So true, you can make such an impact when you look at the points tally at the end of the season, just 1 week. Someone that I know you're a huge fan of, and we'll be speaking to him later on, Mickey van der Ven. Great to see him back the other night.
Yeah, he's one of the standout players of the season through the course of it, I think, and just to have his presence in the team. It's crazy to think that a player this young has created such a presence, but the partnership with himself and Romero has been wonderful, and I think having him back on the side gives everybody around him the confidence, I think, also for us to push a little bit further up the pitch.
There's this strange thing that I absolutely love watching. Every single week you'll see a player receive a pass out on the wing. They won't look up. They'll bring the ball down and think, I'm going to run with this. Yeah. And then they look up and see it's Mickey that they're taking on this thing. Forget it. No. Just pass it back.
Just pass it back, isn't it? It's that one time you see a ball go over the top, you go on, you're like, do you want to see that chase? Do you want to see him get there? But no, it is. It's an amazing confidence to have in a defender that you feel, no matter how much ground there is to be got at, he can make it up. And whoever the opponent is going to look at him and think second thoughts about whether they're going to try and take him on or not, which is great to have.
It's great to see him back. Another massive milestone for our skipper. 400 appearances up for Sonny. Just talk us through what you've made of his time at Spurs.
He's been a revelation. Really, he really has. His contribution in goals, his assists, his all-around play, his demeanour. I mean, you take all that away, his demeanour around the place and how nice a guy he is, how often people just say how much he lifts the spirits of the other people around him. You know, if he wasn't providing what he provides, which is insane, his actual personality would override everything. So to put that all into one thing, he's an absolute gem. And as a Tottenham fan, as a Tottenham ex-player, so lucky to have a player like this in the club. And now that he's the club captain, just, you know, puts it all together nicely.
One thing that jumps out at me is this unerring consistency, not just in his form, and you see it there, 240-plus goal involvements across 400 appearances, but his consistency of character as well. What does that do for you as a player to have someone like that that you can just look at every single day and know he's going to be at the top of his game and he's going to bring wonderful energy as well?
You know what it is? When you have players, sometimes you have players and like they're dependable, and you know they're going to be 6 or 7 out of 10 every week, and you know that's perfect. But he's a 9 out of 10 every week, and that's ridiculous to think that his level of consistency is off the chart. And every time an opportunity comes, they think maybe he's not going to take it. He does. To have a player like that that you can constantly rely on and play that many games consistently back to back over an 8-9 year period. He's remarkable in what he's doing and what he's still doing at this club.
Yeah, no doubt we'll be leading the line again this weekend against Nottingham Forest. Let's talk a little bit about them and their form, because they've found over the course of the last few weeks just a little bit of an upturn.
I think it was a similar sort to what happened when Everton had the points taken off them. It kind of galvanised them as a group, didn't it? It made them feel like it's the world against us, we need to get back at it. And I think Forest have started to put a run together, they started to pick up points. They've got some very good attacking players, quick, pacey, which we can deal with, but they do leave themselves exposed when poaching. That's something we can take on. But listen, this will be a tough test, but it's definitely one I feel can get us on that run, that momentum we need for winning games at home.
Yeah, that's really crucial, right? As we go into this kind of next phase of the season, there are some enormous games on the horizon. You can only look at the next one. Yeah. You can't help but be aware of the fact that there's a North London derby to come, there's a huge game against Chelsea to come, a massive game against Liverpool in there, and City as well. This needs to be a strong performance this weekend.
It really does, yeah. You want to get the confidence you need in this game to show what we can do. And listen, as much as we're looking at Forest and everybody's going to be worried about us because of what we've done this season, because of what we can do. So, you know, you don't take that for granted. You don't think about how worried teams are going to be playing against us. All those teams that are pushing for the top of the table clash, they're going to be looking at us thinking we're the one that's going to make them slip up. So it's important we use that to our strength as well. But you go into Forest, we have to have confidence we can win the game, and especially at home, it's something that we should be looking to really go and get 3 points.
We'll come back to our first team a little later on. Next up, though, we're going to be speaking to one of the stars of our under-21s, Tyrese Hall. Let's see how his side qualify for the semi-finals of the League Cup.
Santiago making the burst. Finds Will Langshot, who is denied by the goalkeeper, but Santiago continues his run, and Spurs find the breakthrough goal in this Premier League Cup quarter-final tie, and they lead by 1-0. Santiago charging through. Found Will Lancashire in space, but then nobody tracked the run of the Spaniards, and he was there to follow up. Aston Villa 0, Spurs 1. Aston Villa can break away. And they break through the middle, and they get themselves into a good position, and it's smashed in early on in this second half for an equalising goal by Caden Young. It's the perfect start to the second half for Aston Villa. Spurs opened up with ease, and Caden Young with a lovely strike beyond Luka Gunter. Tyrese Hall finds the angle for Soon Sub Bell. He delivers in, and Spurs are back ahead. Jamie Donnelly, who scored against Aston Villa in the Premier League Cup final last season for the under-18s in this quarter-final tie, does the business for the under-21s. Soon Sub Bell with the perfect pass, and Jamie Donnelly with the perfect finish. Charging down, Spurs win it back, and there we go. Will Langshaw takes his chance and sends Spurs into the semi-final of the Premier League Cup.
And we're joined by one of the standout performers from our 21s team, Tyrese Hall. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
First cap on the sofa. Absolutely delighted to get you on. Talk us through the other night.
Top win away at Villa, into the semi-finals. Hopefully we can get to the final winner. So I feel like that's the main goal at the moment, but taking it one step at a time.
And you've had an interesting season because you've been playing with the different age groups, right? So talk us through that.
Started off the season with the 18s. Then made my 21s debut against Cambridge in the EFL Trophy. And I think ever since we came back from Christmas, mixed a little bit in January with the 18s and 21s because we had FA Youth Cup. But ever since then, I've been building on with the 21s, so it's been good.
Yeah, and it's a very exciting group to be a part of. Some amazing players in there that are pushing to be a part of the first team as well. Yeah. What is the standard jump like when you go from 18s, and what are the differences?
I feel like the standard jumps, there's definitely a jump for like the intensity, like the physicality side of it as well. Playing it's bigger, like smarter, faster players, so you have to be able to adapt better compared to the 18s. But I feel like I've adapted well, and like the boys have made me feel comfortable, so that's also been helpful, so it's been good.
Yeah, what about when you drop back down? I spoke to you just a moment ago. When you go back down, do you feel like there's a change in your game? Then you're moving the ball quicker. You feel it's easier. Is that because I found that when I was a young lad, when I would drop back down again, but still maintain those levels?
Yeah, I feel like definitely playing with the 21s when I've gone back down with the 18s, it's made it a lot easier. For like, I'm able to do my stuff better because I'm like more stronger from playing against stronger players. So I feel like it's definitely helped a lot when I've dropped back down to the 18. So yeah.
Tell us a bit about your game, Terrace. What do you model your game around?
I feel like, I like to say an all-round midfielder. I feel like mostly on the ball. I feel like definitely over the last two seasons, like my off-the-ball stuff, the coaches in and around the building, I helped that side of my game improve a lot, like getting about, winning the ball back, like landing on second ball and stuff like that. So, yeah.
Seems like you get a lot of joy from being on the ball, under pressure. You're one of the players that already so many people are building comps around. I see like highlights comps of you just taking people on. Do you enjoy that side of your game?
No, yeah, definitely. I feel like having a player on your back at all times also makes you like more aware. So I feel like if I have a player on my back, I'm just able to like do my stuff better. If like there's no one on my back, it's kind of like, it's not really the same. So,
like, you want that pressure.
Yeah, like I kind of like that pressure on me. I feel like it makes me a better player, so yeah.
The awareness of those players behind you. So when you're receiving, do you do a lot of work with training with Stu and that, with like receiving and looking over your shoulder, or is it just something that kind of happens natural for you?
I feel like a bit of both. I feel like they've helped me train it, and it's also like become a habit now, just like checking my shoulders, like if I'm receiving it with someone on my back, like holding them off, or like just making sure I know my surroundings.
Screening and making sure there's no one.
Who would you say your game's most like in terms of when you look at the first team?
Definitely Bissouma. I feel like the way he plays, like just smooth on the ball, like getting in and out of tight gaps. So yeah, I'd say Bissouma.
Have you ever met Eve? Have you done anything with him before? Has he ever seen you play?
No, but I've trained over the first team side a couple times. So I'm not sure if he remembers me, but hopefully he does.
I'm sure he does.
Yeah, I think that's the thing. When you're a young lad and you go across, you just want to create an impact, don't you? So you're trying to want them to talk about you when you leave. By doing the right things, which is important for you when you go on, that's what you're trying to improve on.
How did you find it, training with the first?
No, it's definitely tough. For like, the intensity demands are like really high. For like, I don't know how to explain it. For like, it's just so different to what anyone would expect. But like, it's they help you a lot when you're over there. Like, they talk to you, they make sure you're comfortable. Like, they're not leaving you out. So then, that helps.
This is a bit of a toughie, but could you tell us the best piece of advice that you've had since you've kind of been in the 18s and 21s that's helped you the most?
For like, it's not really like anything major, it's like making sure you're running. For like, as important as your stuff is on the ball, for like, the more you do it off the ball, the more the ball you'll have. It's like running about, winning the ball back, like I said. And once you do that, you'll have more of the ball, so.
It's crazy you say that. That's literally what Steve... I caught with Stephen this morning. That's literally what he said to me this morning. I think it was your first ever tour, right? Yeah. Your first pre-season tour.
So I was saying to Ben that I said, you're now at the stage where you're looking at pre-season tour. So you're looking at pre-season next year, you're thinking, can I get on that trip? Can I get in the first team all the time? And that's a huge step when you get to there. But I remember saying my first pre-season was just like, I was just trying to run away from the first team players, just trying to do everything I could to just sprint away and do everything fast feet, and everything was just intensity levels. And at the time, they weren't too happy with you because they don't want you to run off. But the better ones and the older pros would come over and say, listen, don't ever stop doing that. So that's it. Your intensity, your fitness, just keep that up and that'll make a huge difference.
You were lightning fast as well, which is going to drive everyone absolutely mad. Tell me about how the 21s are looking as we go into the back end of the season. I think we can actually have a look at the table. I mean, you guys have been flying.
Yeah,
what do you put that down to?
For like, just teamwork and work effort, really. For like, the team... Even though I haven't been around it as much as others, I feel like it's gelled so well. And I feel like we just work like so well together, like everything works. Wayne also giving us like tactics and stuff, but also us like bringing it out on the pitch and doing it. But yeah, that works a lot.
It's been a really special season, and that record is stunning, Stephen.
Yeah, it is fantastic, isn't it? It's an amazing.
Yeah,
it's always nice when you're ahead of three other London teams. I think it just makes it a little bit nicer.
So just tell us your ambitions now for the remainder of the season. What are you hoping to achieve, Tyrese?
No, I just hope to end the season as strong as possible with the 21s for that top of the league into semi-final of a cup, for that, hoping we can win a couple of trophies and then just coming back as strong as possible in pre-season.
We've got everything crossed for you. I hope it's a really, really successful end of the season. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Excellent stuff. Next up on the sofa, Mickey van der Ven is with us. But first, here's a little snippet from this week's Off the Shelf with Michael Dawson.
It'd been a long time coming, my first goal, and I was getting an awful lot of stick for it, by the way. Not the fact that I'd missed so many chances, just I didn't get my big head on it and put it in the back of the net. And when I did get that goal, I was just used to joke that I was saving it for a big game, and I certainly did that. 1-0 down against Chelsea, and then I get us back to level pegging. Great, great ball in by JJ. I just had to get something on it. It was a slight glance in front of Didier Drogba. It was a handful. What a centre forward he was. And then Lenny, I remember Lenny's boots, yellow boots he wore in that game.
Did he?
Yellow boots, brand spankers they were. And I'm thinking, Lenny, you're brave. When the boots weren't that crazy, then anyone wears anything now. And he chopped inside and put it in the middle of the goal and to win 2-1. But after a long, long time for Spurs to win it, beat Chelsea at White Lane, it was certainly a special, special day. And the atmosphere, and one I never forget because it was rocking. And that, I think that showed the gap that we'd closed, because Chelsea, as you say, were winning Premier Leagues, were
superior. You could see that we were progressing, weren't we?
We were progressing. Yeah.
Make sure you do check out the episode with Dawes. Loads of great episodes up there on Off the Shelf. I'm delighted to say we are now joined by Mickey van der Ven. How are you, sir?
Good. How are you?
Yeah, very, very well. How are you holding up? How was the other night?
Yeah, it's good. Yeah, enjoying it.
Fine?
Yeah. Everything fine. Enjoying it, yeah.
Okay, so you've been here for, what is it, 9 months now? 8-9 months now?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Does it feel like home yet?
Yeah, for sure. To be honest, it's quite difficult where you come from another team that felt like home. To build like a new home, to make a new home, but the guys helped me and the club and everybody here around helped me, so it feels like home already, yeah.
You've got a really nice group as well.
Yeah,
you've got a really lovely group. Who are you tight with in and amongst the squad?
Now also with Timo, to be honest. When he joined the winter, I can speak German with him, so that's also, it's quite nice. But like with everyone, Destiny, Vic, also a lot with Vic. I'm going quite well with everyone. The South American guys also with Guti, Rodri, Gio, so like everyone.
Yeah, it's fun when you make guys that are from different backgrounds that just all come together, melting pot. You find out how much you actually have in common with different people, isn't it, when you're thrown into that situation?
Yeah. To be honest, it's strange with shit because everybody speaks a different language, but still you grow to each other. And sometimes when the Spanish guys talk Spanish, I don't even understand something, but I just feel the vibe where they're talking about. Yeah. So that's what also makes us grow together.
How has your game changed since you've come here, Mickey?
What do you mean, game?
In terms of your personal game, like the way that you play, do you feel that you've changed at all in terms of your playing style?
Yeah, of course, because every gaffer plays another system. But yeah, of course, Premier League is different than the Bundesliga. I think Premier League is the highest level you can play. So you played against the best strikers in the world, the best attackers in the world. So I think I improved with some games and also with experience. Yeah.
Do you think people back home have started to take more notice of you? I mean, you've become a Dutch international, which is absolutely amazing.
Yeah.
How was that experience for you?
Yeah, I think I've noticed. Yeah, people notice me more now in Holland. I think also because Premier League is, people in Holland, I think all over the world, watch Premier League more than they watch the Bundesliga. So I think they knew me already with the Bundesliga, but now when you play Premier League, when you play a big team in the Premier League, people will recognize you more, will look more how you play every game and how are you doing? But I think, yeah, they know me more now in how I am as a player.
Making the jump to international football, for me, when I did that was such an incredible thing, because you kind of, I always had playing for Ireland was just something that I want to achieve. For you, was it a goal that you've got now and you're just so proud of?
Yeah. Really, it was also because it was in the Amsterdam Arena, the Johan Cruyff Arena, was the stadium where I made my debut. And then when I was younger, I always went to this stadium with my dad to watch Ajax. So it was a special feeling to make in this stadium my debut for the national team. And it's a boyhood dream. Like when you're small, you want to play for the national team. And
and want to stand there, so hopefully I can play more games and be at the Euros.
Do you know what's mad? I think I'm right in saying as well, the Netherlands base camp this summer is going to be Wolfsburg.
Yeah.
How mad is that for you?
It's crazy.
Absolutely
it's
incredible.
Crazy. Going back home.
Amazing. Mickey, one thing that jumped out at me over this last couple of weeks, you obviously missed a couple of games. You got the full experience of what it is to be a Spurs fan. There were some lovely shots of you on the bench and you are soaking up every moment. Yeah. How hard was it for you to watch?
No, it's so difficult. It's so difficult to watch. Like, when you're playing on, if you're 2-1 up and it's minute 85 or something on the bench, you want to do something. You know, you get so nervous and everything. But when you're playing, you're calm. You don't feel the pressure. You're just like you're playing. But when you're on the bench, you're like, hey, you're looking at the time every 10 seconds or something. So to watch from the side is so difficult.
Have you seen these videos?
I've seen them, yeah.
It's so funny, man. All of you guys are literally just like us on the side. You're all standing there like this.
It's crazy.
You've got no control, right? There's nothing you can do to impact it.
That's the thing. You can do something. Most of the time you're involved in it, so you don't, what I said, you don't feel the pressure, but now you have to look from the side. You know?
Welcome to being a Spurs fan, Mickey. This is what it is. Just talk us through this weekend. Another really important game. How much are you looking forward to being back in action at the stadium?
I'm always happy to play home games. It's so nice with the stadium, the fans, and hopefully we can get a good game and important 3 points, I think, for this weekend. Also to bounce back after West Ham, I think, we drew over there, but we wanted more, of course. We came there to get the 3 points, and I think if you look at the play, we quite dominated the game also. So then when you don't get the 3 points, it's a bit frustrating. So now for sure we want to grab the 3 points on Sunday.
Mickey, got everything crossed for you. Good luck this weekend.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Well, it feels like a huge game, an important one this afternoon. Pedro Porro in. Kane with a header, super one. Harry Kane with a header. Wild and wrong. Keylor Navas between the posts and beaten. 2-0 Spurs. Bearing down on goal, goes early, tries to find Son. Bit blocked by Worrell. Richarlison still going. Son takes and shoots and finds the corner. Super work from the Spurs attack. Spurs 3, Forest 0 past the hour. In by Gibbs White. Oh, and they have got a goal. And Joe Worrell heads into the net. To appealing for handball as Shelby drives it ever towards goal. He's had one look, he's had two looks, and that is enough. So Forrest get a penalty. Are you looking for his first goal for Nottingham Forest? But he's denied by Forster. Brilliant save, and now Spurs counter. The Spurs do get the win, and it was a needed win to respond. Full time in N17, finishes Spurs 3, Forest 1.
Take another one of those this weekend, won't we? Let's move on and do some tactical analysis today. We've got some really, really good stuff to get into, and we're going to start with a former Forest player, Brennan Johnson. Stephen, how impressed have you been with him over the course of the last couple of weeks?
It's just been great to really see him flower, I think, at Tottenham. Just comes down, and I saw him so many times for Forest, and when he signed, I was so excited for what we have in our hands here, a young, just wonderful talented player. But this is what he's adding to his game now. It's getting in the right positions, reading where the ball is going to end up and getting in there. And that's really important for him.
Really crucial that we got that goal so early in the game against West Ham. But that comes off the back of him having impact both in front of goal, creating as well. So we see two assists here. Firstly, it's his brilliant cross. And then on top of that, we've got a very deft touch into Sonny as well.
Yeah, this one just slows it down, a little 1-2 apart, but then he just whips into that corridor of uncertainty, which is, like I said, it's horrible as a defender, but Werner gets in, good position, a great ball in. And that's just knowing that he's going to be able to do that and put the ball in a decent area. And then this is him again, knowing he has to get into the box. He has to be in the right position to affect the play. And this time it's a wonderful layoff to Sonny. So it's those goal involvements, it's those important positions, knowing where you need to be and arrive at the right time, that's changed slightly for us.
So the goal contributions have really, really racked up for Brennan's fifth goal of the season, having a really big impact that way. But I also wanted to talk about some of the stuff that maybe has gone unnoticed as well, that I think comes off the back of him playing with such confidence, both his crossing and his ability to drag the team up the pitch.
Yeah, he's getting himself into great areas, but you even see here, that's instinctive now. He's getting his head down, he knows he's had a little quick look and he whips across, and then this situation where if you can have a player that can drive the team forward, get the ball to their feet and they're willing to bring it out from the back, get in another position, goes past the player here, gets his head up and, you know, he's constantly looking for the pass. We know we can go on the outside, but having that ability to come inside as well as a defender, that throws you because you think, right, he's going to go on the outside all the time. I'll open my body up. As soon as he goes inside, that changes it for you. And he's starting to do that now. And this one just uses the defender and feeds around them. That wonderful ball in. Like I said, that's that corridor of uncertainty, which is, as a defender, it's horrible to play against. And for him to start, he's constantly finding balls in there. So the more you do that, the more those players are coming at the far post, putting them in. So yeah, he's been excellent of late.
So, so impressive. Mm. Let's go from the forward line to the back line. Mm. I wanted to talk a little about Kuti Romero. Mm. Now, I was going to use the stat that he'd gone 13 games or 12 games without a booking. Yeah. Nicked a booking the other night, but he's been so clean over the course of the last few games. Let's look at him both out of possession and in possession. Now, one of the things against Luton, we saw that Spurs obviously play with a very, very high line, which means he's having to take the ball under pressure a lot of times. Can you talk us through what is required as a defender to play in this way?
He's so calm. I think you just need to have patience about you. And what he does is when he receives the ball, he doesn't panic. He's just so relaxed in possession of the ball. And I think there's an inner belief and confidence that he can pick that pass, can find that player.
You can see it in his body language, can't you?
Yeah.
He's sort of so relaxed on the ball.
You know what it is as well? Sometimes when you're playing, you're that relaxed. You almost don't want to go close to him because you think he's just going to find the pass past me. So I don't want to go exposing myself. But, you know, he does it from the back. He does it from the areas. And then his defensive ability, I spoke about him earlier saying he's like a rash. But as soon as the ball bounces, he's on you. He doesn't give. He knows he can sense the player. It is Antonio. We know he's got pace. He realizes if I can get away from him, but I need to be close. I need to be tight. I need to be on the first foot. So I think his front foot defending is brilliant. That's what makes him. I think the confidence having Mickey beside him knows that he can go in and commit to those tackles, knowing that you've got the cover behind. And I think he's such a crucial player for us.
Yeah, he doesn't seem to give anyone any space at all. So front footed in terms of his defending. Didn't really put a foot wrong the other night. And let's go back to talking about him on the ball. One of the things that I thought was superb away at the London Stadium was his ability to break lines with his passes as well.
He always looks for a forward pass. You rarely see him. I know as a centre-back, you're often your ball's forward because that position you're playing, but in situations like this, that's like a reverse pass, and it's not a silly no-look pass where you throw your head one way after you've played it. It's actually a pass where he's looked one way and fed it in without looking at it. And it just shows his confidence and ability on the ball. But to have a player like that when they step up into those midfield areas as well, can pick a pass, and then you're finding the likes of Maddison higher up the pitch, just gives us a different depth to us.
Do you think that because he's got Mickey next to him, he's able to be even more front-footed?
100%. My favourite player, and people, Tottenham fans would love this, was when I played beside Ledley, I just knew I could go. I didn't even think about it because I knew he would cover the space. Romero will have the same opinion, and as a left back, Doggy will have the same thing. You don't even think about leaving the space behind because you know you've got someone that will just eat up the ground and cover for you. And that just becomes a self-belief and a confidence that you can go.
Yeah, really, really special to see Kuti in such wonderful form. Time now to get a bit of team news from the boss. Here's Ange Postecoglou.
Okay, Ange's here. Ange, you're going to head to Forest on Sunday. It's going to start with team news, as we always do. How are we looking?
Yeah, not too bad. The only one from the other night is Richie. He's had a bit of a niggle with his knee, so we'll probably give him this weekend off just to get totally over it. Hopefully be ready for Newcastle next week. Everyone else got through the game well, and ready to go.
Just looking at the longer term injuries, are they progressing how you want? I know they probably won't be involved, but...
Man or Fraser and Sess are unlikely to be involved again this year, but they are in rehab.
Right. Okay, I saw pictures of the players coming off at West Ham, the looks on their faces when they came through that tunnel. I think that's a brilliant sign, and just a team who wants to go places, isn't it?
Yeah, look, we were disappointed. I think the players were disappointed, but as I said to them afterwards, no point to be disappointed. What you've got to do is try and, put into action what we need to make sure that we aren't disappointed at the end. But at the same time, it wasn't through a lack of effort, I thought. It's a tough place to go to. They're a tough team to play against. And, the players pushed as hard as they could. It's just, like I said, we lack some of the final details, but that's OK. We know we've got areas to improve, and that's one of them.
Just looking at Forest, obviously Nuno in there now, mixes it up in terms of team selection. What are you expecting at our stadium on Sunday?
Yeah, I think Nuno's obviously came in at a difficult time, and I think he's kind of steadied the ship there a bit. But irrespective, they're fighting for everything. So that's what we've got to expect. And pretty much every game is going to be like that between now and the end of the year. You know, not just our game, but you look at all the games across the board, and everyone's fighting for something. And Forrest's certainly got plenty to fight for, so it won't be an easy game for us. And we've got to be up for it. We've got to be up for the battle. And we've got to work hard on the day, and then also try and impose our football style on them.
Just looking at the bigger picture, I mean, you're going to go into a press conference in a minute, and they're going to ask you about top four again. And it's not a subject I've really sort of spoke to you about, because I know you are looking beyond that. But I'd just be fascinated to, if you could just explain to fans why are you looking beyond that, and, you know, not top four. You don't see that as an achievement, because you want more, you want to see more. I'm just fascinated, because, as I say, it's not a subject that we've spoken about, and you get asked about it every week.
No, I think it's pretty simple. I think, you know, as I said, I don't think top four is the ambition. I don't think, you know, I get that, you know, top four means Champions League football, so there is a reward there, and I think that's a significant reward and something you should strive for. It's just that my sort of position on it is not so much, particularly this year, where we finish, is, you know, what kind of team we are. Because, you know, if we finish fourth and, you know, we're 25 points off top spot, I'm not sure that that's the kind of trajectory we want to be on. So it's part of just really making sure that the players and, you know, we're all focused on what the ultimate ambition is. You know, if we finish fourth this year, what it does show is that, you know, we're progressing, we've made improvements, but, you know, that's not the end goal. And that's why, for me, it's much more important how we play between the end of the year and how we finish the year. And then we assess things, you know, and we finish fourth and I feel like we've made some progress and we're set up for next year, then I'll be pleased with that.
And the biggest thing here, this is such a young group of players as well, and in their first season under you.
Yeah, you know, and for a lot of them, the first year in the Premier League. So I think, like I said, they're the things that are much more important to me in terms of, you know, where we're heading than just the finishing position. I think my kind of sort of reticence to kind of hold that as some kind of charisma, people think that that's all that we're about, just finishing fourth. And of course, I want to finish fourth, I want to finish as high as possible, but, you know, knowing that we've got growth in us is much more important.
It's really fascinating to listen to Ange there and talk about not wanting to put a ceiling and not wanting to put a cap on what is a very, very talented group. That's a real marked change in terms of the way that the manager's talking, not from himself, but from perhaps previous managers that we've had at the club before.
It's seeing a potential within a group of players and realising that there is no limit to what these can really achieve, and the right mix, the right style, and the way they're playing. And it was really interesting to hear him talking about the players. Some of them, the first time in the Premier League, it's his first time in the Premier League, and it's his, he's learning as he's going and adapting to different styles, different managers you're facing for the first time, understanding the perils of how you play in the Premier League and what dictates how you win a game. And I think, see it all come together with a young group of players that are all bought into it. It's fascinating, and it's been such an eventful season. It's been brilliant so far, and just finish it strong and get to the highest position we can.
Particularly if your belief is that this is a side that can reach the very, very top of both English football, I'm sure I'd be thinking about Europe as well. The last thing you want to do is then say, okay, great for us to reach top four, because it changes the narrative that you have within yourself, but also the one that you're sharing with the team.
You're setting limitations. Why would you want to set a limitation to a player or put something in their mind that they only have to get to there? No, go higher. Go as high as you can. Have them think limitlessly about what they can achieve as a group of players. Don't restrict them at all. And that's what he's trying to get. He's trying to create a mindset that these players can achieve whatever they feel they're capable of by doing the right things. And I think that's an amazing attitude to have.
Yeah, well, fingers crossed it sort of spreads within that group, because there's no real ceiling to what they can achieve, not just over the course of the next few seasons, but also over the course of the remaining eight games that we've got. I want to talk a little about our women's team, Steve, and I know that preparations are well underway for the FA Cup semi-final next weekend, on next Sunday. How special for that group that they'll play both at Tottenham Hotspur Stadium, but for the opportunity to play at Wembley in an FA Cup final as well?
Historically, you know, to make that level where they've got to the semi-final for the first time is wonderful, but to go one step further and to have it at your home ground, where, you know, let's get that packed out, let's get behind them, because, you know, as a club you go forward together, And now it's all one inclusive place. You want the women's side to be pushing up as well, the same as the women. You want both sides to be fighting for trophies, fighting for things. And it's important that as a fan base, everybody's in behind the women as well. But it's important week internationally before that, so it'd be good.
Yeah, it's such an amazing opportunity. Do get involved. TottenhamHotspur.com/tickets. There are tickets still available. Get down to spot our women's team. Men are playing on Saturday, so no excuse for us all. Get down there to that stadium and make sure you get behind our team. They're having a wonderful season, playing some incredible football, and a real opportunity for that side to go on and create even more history and reach their first ever FA Cup final. Let's just have a look at the Premier League fixtures that are coming up this weekend. And it's not just the Spurs game that we're looking out for, but as you were rightly pointing out earlier on, Stephen, the fact that we play last game on Sunday night will have a very good idea of what's going on around us as well.
Yeah, not that that should change anything really. You're going at home to Nottingham and you want to win that game, you want to get the 3 points, but you're always conscious of the teams you're battling with. For us, it's the Villa game. All Tottenham fans are going to be watching that Villa-Brentford game, see what happens, see what comes through and what position we're going to be in after that. And then some really important fixtures. The Man U Liverpool one is one that jumps out as well. But for us, it's about maintaining that levels that we have, taking on from West Ham, bringing it up, getting 3 points and going into next week in a position where we're potentially ahead of Villa.
And we know that Spurs are ultimately going to be the side that has the biggest say now on the title race. We're still to play Arsenal, still to play City, and still to play Liverpool in there as well.
Yeah, it really is. It's fascinating. It's a great title race. Top three are just all added to each other, but I think every single one of those teams is going to be worried about us and what we can bring and that we can take points off them. And I think as a Spurs fan, that can give you some sort of confidence or some sort of belief that this team is going in the right direction, because of all those teams are going to be looking and thinking, where are we going to drop points? And Spurs is the one they're going to be most worried about. So that for us is a nice position to be in. Ideally, we'd like to be higher, but we're going to have an impact and we're going to get that fourth.
One way or another, we're going to have a huge impact on what happens at the top of this table over the course of the next few weeks. How's it going to play out against Forest, Stephen?
Home win, I'd like to say 2-0 plus. That's what I'm going with. I want to keep it like that.
Clean sheet.
Yeah, nice clean sheet.
Three goals minimum.
Mickey and Romero there, we're sorted.
Love that. Thank you so much, Stephen. What a pleasure.
Cheers.
And thank you so much for watching at home. Just a quick reminder, this weekend we'll have the warm-up show for you from 45 minutes before kickoff. So make sure you come and join us for that live on Spurs Play and on YouTube, as well as that we'll also have the review show. And you can catch back the full 90 from midnight onwards. After, as we always say, and hopefully as is the case this weekend, Spurs have gone out and got a really, really good win, ideally 3-0 against Nottingham Forest. Thanks so much for watching and good luck to Ange and the boys this weekend. Come on, you Spurs.